Good morning and welcome to this, the 15th meeting of the European and External Relations Committee in 2015. We have apologies from our colleague Hanzala Malik and we send him our best wishes. We have a rare substitute in Claire Baker and we welcome Claire to committee. Could I make the usual request that mobile phones are switched off and interfere with our broadcasting system? Our second agenda item of this morning is to agree to take agenda item 5 in private. Has committee agreed to do that? Agenda item 3 this morning is our Brussels Bulletin, which is pretty full this morning. Happy to take comments, questions or clarifications on the Brussels Bulletin. Colleagues, Willie?
Thanks, convener. On page 5 there, one of the recurring subjects that this committee looks at on broadband, you'll note that the European Commission is launching a public consultation for broadband beyond 2020 and what that should look like. I was wondering, convener, if the committee might be tempted to even submit a response to this and outline some of the thoughts and hopes that this committee has expressed over the past few years in this matter. I see the deadline for responses is the 7th of December and that responses will be published by January. So I would very much hope that whether members do that individually or even this committee submitting a view on that, I think would be very helpful and would make a good contribution to that argument.
I mean, I don't think it's either or. I think, you know, we could do both if people were minded to do so, but certainly I think the committee's heard enough evidence to maybe put together something. Would you be able to work with Katie on that?
I'd love to do that.
Yeah. Is that okay? We can pull, because this is an issue that Willie's raised a number of years on this committee now, so gives us an opportunity to put our thoughts across.
I mean, obviously the members have got their views and they're a valuable part of whatever this committee would say, so there's quite a lot we've had to say over the past few years on this convener, and it gives us an opportunity to shape the Commission's thinking going beyond 2020.
And I'm sure we've got enough evidence we can draw on for that. Yeah, we can do that.
Super.
Yeah, anything else? Rod.
Just on the bit on the investment court system, TTIP, it says the Commission will discuss the proposal with the European Parliament of Member State Governments. Following these discussions, the Commission will present the investment court system proposal to US negotiators as part of the TTIP negotiations. Just wondered if there was a timetable for that or whether we can be flagged up how that actually will progress. Because that presumably is before the full TTIP agreement as the European Parliament and potential member states. It must be done much, much more quickly than that.
Yeah. Well, we can find out and bring that back to committee. Anything else on the Brussels Bulletin? Willie?
Thanks again, convener. See on page 6 there on the heading Employment, Skills and Education, there's an interesting little note there on mobile workers. If you note what it says there, the Court of Justice has decided that workers without a fixed or habitual place of work between their homes and the first and last customer of the day constitutes working time. So people who travel to work in those circumstances in those particular sectors, that is now actually being regarded as working time. That will have some hopefully positive implications for many people in a variety of sectors, and it would be worth following that up again when the timetables for that might actually be.
Keep an eye on it. I know that the STUC and I think the TUC are doing a bit of work on this now and trying to identify the groups of workers most likely to be affected. And in some of the sectors, it's care workers who you maybe are home helps or, you know, that go straight through their home to somebody else's home. And then the same, and travel around all day. So I think the trade unions are looking at that, but we could certainly find out a bit more information, because they have to find out what categories of workers actually fall into the scope. So that bit of work's been done, I believe. Choose that up. Yeah, excellent. Anything else on the Brussels Bulletin? No. Can we agree to share the Brussels Bulletin with other committees? Is there any specific topics we should raise with individual subject committees? Jamie?
I just want a heading saying, I know I'm always going on about fisheries, environment, climate, rural and fisheries. There doesn't seem to be anything on fisheries. And since there's a big fisheries bill going through Europe at the moment, I think that's rather odd.
It's just the heading. There's headings for each area, and it's...
Say again, I think it's very badly set out, and it's much better the way it used to be. But that's it. I don't know why they do it like this nowadays compared to what it was before.
It's
a much lesser report than it used to be.
Ian Duncan's been named as a lead rapporteur on
emissions. I know, he was the person who used to sort out the report.
Well, we've been there, we have unstable that
platform. But, I mean, it says environment, climate, rural and fisheries, and then there's nothing about fisheries. You know, that must be wrong. I mean, I don't know who's doing it.
Okay, we can have a...
Because there is a big fisheries bill going through, and I it ought to say something about it.
Well, if it's not there, we can ask for it to be there. We can request that information.
Is that always the heading that's there?
Yes.
I see. All right.
Yeah. It's the portfolio headings. Yeah.
I think there's something on chemicals under it.
So it's grouped under committees, Jamie, and that's the name of that committee.
Yeah.
You require some additional information about the fisheries bill, we can ask for that.
Yeah, okay.
That's the whole purpose. So.
Yeah. Well, I would quite like to know what's going on.
Right, okay. I'm sure we'll get a chance in Strasbourg next week to talk to some people as well that we can talk to about this.
I keep in touch, obviously, with it. But...
Okay.
Just to clarify that as well, I mean, the employment skills and education portfolio is there too, but there's nothing in that, those subtexts about education.
Yeah.
But that's just that portfolio heading, that's all it is.
Yeah, all right. But I'll take that point. But
we will find you something on what the most up to date position on fisheries, Jenny.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, with the Brussels Bulletin then, can we make sure our committees are highlighted? Yep. Okay, happy to move on. I'm going to briefly suspend to allow all our witnesses to come in and just go into their round table. So, suspend now. morning and welcome back to the European and External Relations Committee. And we start again with our agenda item 4, which is a roundtable discussion about the refugee crisis and the EU. Can I welcome all of our visitors today to committee? We're very pleased to have you all here and to hear some of the work that you're involved in. We're going to try and run it like a bit of an open discussion, so if you can just, you know, get your hand up or give me a nod or something, let me know that you want in. And we will start in the room and we'll come to Aspasia last so that we can do that as free-flowing as possible. So we'll do introductions around the table, if that's okay. So starting with myself, so I'm Christina McKelvey. I'm the convener of the European and External Relations Committee.
I'm Willie Coffey, MSP for Kilmarnock and the Irvine Valley.
I'm Duncan Campsie from Glasgow City Council.
I'm Roderick Campbell, MSP for North East Fife.
I'm Gonzalo Vargas Llosa from UNHCR London.
Adam Ingram, MSP for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley.
Joanna Zavatska, Fife Migrants Forum Manager.
Anne McTaggart, MSP Glasgow.
Derry Mitchell, Convention of Scottish Local Authorities.
Margaret Woods from the Glasgow Campaign to Welcome Refugees.
Amal Azzudin from the Glasgow Girls Campaign.
John Wilkes from the Scottish Refugee Council. I suppose I should also note for the record that I'm also chairing one of the subcommittees of the Ministerial Task Force, but I'm here today primarily in my capacity as the Scottish Refugee Council. But I'm also happy to answer questions about the task force if I can.
I'm Claire Baker, MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife.
I'm Alison Phipps. I'm Professor of Languages and Intercultural Studies at the University of Glasgow and co-convener of Glasgow Refugee Asylum Migration Network, GRAMNET.
Jamie McGregor, MSP for Highlands and Islands.
I'm Morag Brown from Argyll and Bute Council.
You're welcome. Aspasia.
I'm Aspasia Papadopoulou, Senior Policy Officer at the European Council for Refugees and Exiles in Brussels.
Excellent. Welcome to you all. We are so delighted to have you all here today. I think we'd maybe just open with a bit of a general question. You know, if any of our guests around the table today can maybe give us a bit of an update, you know, as to where we are now. And I know, Amal, you and Margaret have just come back from Lesbos, and maybe we're very interested in having an update from you from that perspective. But maybe, John, I don't know if you want to open with a bit of an update of where the task force is and where we are now.
Okay. Yes, thank you, convener. Obviously, in Scotland, the response to recent events has been kicked off by the First Minister's Summit just a month or so ago, which was attended by all key stakeholders around the table and all of Scotland's political leaders were present, which all expressed their support for what was happening. And the proposals followed by, on the following Monday, by the UK government's announcement that they would take in 20,000 Syrian refugees from the camps around Syria and not from within Europe over the next 5 years. And the Scottish government has set up a ministerial-led task force to try and coordinate Scotland's response to how to deal with a big scaling up, I think, of taking refugees in through the resettlement process. The UK government has said that their refugees coming in will be given 5 years humanitarian protection status, which affords them all rights and access to things like work and a benefit system if they need that, and so on and so forth. The Home Office is the UK government's determining agency for operating refugee resettlement generally. I mean, there is an ongoing process called the Gateway process, which routinely resettles about 750 refugees a year into the UK. That's mainly delivered through two clusters of local authorities in the northeast and northwest of England. That has been the model that's been used for the Syrian VPR, or Vulnerable Persons Relocation Scheme, that the Home Office had been using in operation since January 2014, when they first said they would take in a small number of Syrian refugees, people from particularly vulnerable categories. And up to the recent events, about 216 people had been brought into the UK using that scheme, which is a scheme where the Home Office directly contracts with individual local authorities to bring in certain numbers of people. I think Scotland should be proud of the fact that up until that point, it played a major part in the 200 people, about a quarter to a third of that, mainly through Glasgow's efforts, and Glasgow should be commended for that, I think. So at the moment, the ministerial task force was convened very quickly to try and coordinate how Scotland could produce a good response to the announcements of Scotland has committed to taking its proportionate fair share of the people coming to the UK, but more if there is capacity in Scotland to do that. I think COSLA has done a fantastic job in terms of marshalling local authorities, and many local authorities have committed already to wanting to take part and currently looking at numbers and so forth. But there are many other agencies that need to be involved in terms of thinking about what we need to do for people who arrive, get settled, but it's also about the longer term integration of people, and that some of those things we need to think more carefully about, I think. So the agencies like the police and health and all of those sorts of things, the third sector, of course, heavily involved. The Scottish Government, as I understand it, has committed £1 million to try and help some of the gaps. Not sure where they spend that yet. They also set up a website to try and coordinate some of the massive public response that's been seen. And certainly my agency, I'm not sure like many other people around the table, have been really taken aback at the speed and the warmth and the generosity of just individuals that have come forward offering all sorts of things. We've been charged by the government to set up the website, which was set up a couple of weeks ago, scotlandwelcomesrefugees.scot, which has the purpose of trying to keep people informed about what's going on, but also a place for people to register their interest and offers of support, which we then just direct to the appropriate agency concerned. More recently, the minister decided to create two subgroups of the task force to look at two very important issues. The first issue was about the issue of accommodation, because without accommodation, you can't resettle people. And that's co-convened by, I think, Margaret Burgess, the Minister for Housing, and COSLA. And that is going to focus on those issues. And the other subgroup, which I've been asked to chair by the Minister, which one meeting has taken place so far, is loosely called integration, which is supposed to look at everything else in the process, to work with all agencies and interests and stakeholders around the table to think about how Scotland can do the best response it can within the constraints that it has. Obviously, the Scottish Government doesn't have control over the resettlement process. That still resides with the UK Government and the Home Office. Although, as the Scottish Refugee Council has said to the Home Office, there's nothing to prevent the Home Office delegating that responsibility to the Scottish Government if it so chose. The Home Office is also currently looking at how it ramps up the current scheme to cope with thousands of people coming in. And I note from meetings that I've attended in London that some of the thinking they've got is that the current scheme may not be scalable up, that there may be need to be changes and adaptations to the scheme to cope with thousands of people. Because at one point, I think they're expecting people like 100 people a week to be coming through the system. So I think in Scotland we have an opportunity and a chance to think about that and think about what sort of things we might propose to do differently. So there have been some ideas floated around, for example, about having some form of reception induction step before people then go on finally to their local authorities, and other thoughts about how things we can do further down the process. So that's all in train at the moment. Clearly, there are financial discussions going on between the Home Office and local authorities, and I'm sure COSLA and those will be able to give you more details about that. I would observe that the Home Office are still in that sort of ramp-up phase, that they are throwing lots of people at this, and it will be a few weeks, I suspect, before they're fully in gear in terms of how they're going to cope with this. The other factor, of course, is that they rely on the UNHCR, who are the International Refugee Agency, because it's the UNHCR's job to identify people in the camps to be put forward to the UK government. And I'm sure that colleagues from UNHCR will be able to give more details about that.
Yeah, I think that's a good overview of what's happening in Scotland. And before I come to Margaret and Amal to give us their understanding of what they experienced in Greece. Gonzalo, I wonder if you could, in linking into what John's just said, and some of the aspects of the global impact and then some of the very local work that you're doing in the resettlement programme. Then, Aspasia, I'll come to you after Gonzalo so that you can give us some insight from Brussels. Okay? There's a slight delay on that. Gonzalo.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, first of all, thank you to the committee for inviting me, and also I want to place on record the sincere appreciation of UNHCR to the political establishment in Scotland, I think that long before that tragic picture of Aylan on the shores of Turkey forced many European leaders to have a more open and humane approach to the victims of this crisis, there were many many politicians, senior politicians in Scotland asking for a long time for this to happen. That takes courage, and we have very much appreciated that. In that sense, I think Scotland has led rather than followed. I think in terms of the extent of the crisis, I mean, I think you're all very much aware of it, so I won't go into details of figures, numbers. I think we all know that we're now past the half million figure in terms of arrivals in Europe through the Mediterranean. I mean, as a preliminary remarks, I would say that there have been some positive developments, I think, on the international, including the European political stage over the past two or three weeks, including, of course, the commitment by the Prime Minister of the UK to resettle 20,000. Some of these things that now appear to perhaps that are perhaps going to happen now, we have the humanitarian actors and some of the political actors have been calling for them for a long time. If I maybe could try to describe the situation through the viewpoint of a Syrian refugee, and of course there are refugees from many other countries coming to Europe, but I will take the Syrian example because obviously the largest number of persons coming across the Mediterranean are from Syria. I mean, when we interview Syrians arriving in the Mediterranean, arriving through the Mediterranean in Europe, and we ask them, you know, what is the main reason? What is, if you had to choose one reason why you have decided to take this perilous journey across the Mediterranean to come to Europe, the answer is almost always because we have lost hope that peace will come to Syria soon or perhaps ever. They don't cite the possible state benefits that they will get in prosperous Europe. They don't cite even the fact that they have family, some have family members here, or the fact that they may have better job opportunities. Of course, all those are important factors, but the primary factor for someone, for example, the ones who are crossing today, is that they have reached a stage where they think that peace is not going to happen in Syria. And so if the international community and Europe wants to see a reversal of the mass movement that is happening now, for people, first of all, to stop crossing the Mediterranean, but eventually also for people to go back to Syria, this will simply not happen without peace in Syria. And I think that the politicians at the international level, but including in Europe, have unfortunately failed in this absolutely critical area. They have not put enough emphasis, time, effort, commitment, courage, leadership to try to forge a political settlement in Syria. In the last few days, of course, in New York, and we've all been following the events around the UN General Assembly, there seems to be more talk. But until that happens, this crisis is not going to stop. The second main factor that Syrian refugees site when we asked them why did you decide to cross the Mediterranean and come here and risk your life in doing so, is because of something else that I think many of us humanitarians have been saying now for a long time, that the conditions in the countries of asylum in the region, in places like Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon, which of course have shown extraordinary generosity towards the refugees, but those conditions, now we're into the fifth year of the war, those conditions are getting worse and worse because the resources of these countries are absolutely and totally exhausted and overstretched. That, what that means is that then refugees have increasing difficulties in getting jobs, in having access to the basic social services, the health, education. And so for many of those people, the safety net so far over the past four and a half years, the safety net has been international aid. Now, on top of all those problems, the international aid has simply not been keeping up to the increasing, to the growing needs in those neighboring countries. Until a few days ago, the main appeal, the main instrument for raising funds for the region was only 41% funded. Now, that means that many of these refugees have been living under less than half a US dollar a day. So if we, you know, for one second, we put ourselves in the mind frame of a Syrian refugee. So he or she has lost any hope that there'll be peace in Syria. He or she have stuck it out in Turkey or Jordan or Lebanon for four and a half years under the most difficult circumstances. And then on top of that, he or she sees or feels abandoned by the international community whose inability to fund programs has meant, in some places, a 40% cut in the food aid. Now, for a person in that state of mind, of course, Europe seems like the only salvation, even if it means getting on one of those boats and risking their lives. Now, again, in the past few weeks, of course, we have seen some positive developments in terms of commitments, including from Europe and from European countries, to significantly boost the aid towards the region. Now, what is key is that those commitments are quickly translated into actual contributions. I think for the time being, I'll leave it there, maybe.
Okay, thank you very much, Gonzalo. Aspasia, do you want to give us an update from the European angle?
Yes, thank you. Well, I would only add to the global context, maybe apart from the old factors that Gonzalo just very eloquently described, also the restrictions that we can currently witness, for example, in terms of legal status and the possibility to stay in countries like Lebanon, the fact that people really remain without legal status, and hence, if they have no legal status, they have no access to services, they can't send their kids to school, and all this creates a situation whereby people cannot just stay there anymore. In a country like Lebanon, which has been hosting refugees for years and years, now becomes a transit country. So all these factors lead to what we currently witness, which is substantial arrivals in Europe. The scale is quite significant, but it's not just the scale in absolute terms. It's also the fact that the response has been uncoordinated. The arrivals have been, of course, uneven, and there have been certain parts of the continent that received substantial pressure, namely, for example, the Greek islands, further in the Balkans. And there has been a clear lack of a proper response, which shows basically that when it comes to sudden arrivals, the European asylum system is just not ready. There is a common European asylum system in terms of laws in place, but when it comes to managing such a situation, it's just not coordinated and not ready. However, it was rightly said just earlier, there has been some traction. Member states have clearly shown an interest. There is a momentum, partly because of a panic, like what to do with the situation, but also partly because there is a realization that this is going to continue. It's not a one-off just this summer and this September. This will go on for a few months and years, maybe, until really the conflict in Syria is resolved, and there needs to be a system in place. I will maybe just briefly remind everybody of what has been the latest steps taken at EU level vis-à-vis the refugee crisis. There have been numerous negotiations, particularly regarding the controversial relocation decision. Eventually, it was decided to relocate 160,000 people from Greece, Italy, and while initially there was Hungary also included, because Hungary doesn't want to consider itself as a frontline state, there is still now this amount of people that remains to be decided whether that will be again from Greece and Italy next year, or whether that will be from another member state facing a particular pressure later on. There has been also more money announced. There's been money particularly in the humanitarian assistance field. I'm not talking only about humanitarian aid to the region, for example, the Madad Trust Fund or additional funding, for example, that has been announced also for Turkey and the Balkans. But there has been also emergency funding made available at EU level for European member states facing a particular pressure. There has been an increase as well at the same time in with regards to the presence at sea, so the assets and resources made available to Poseidon and Triton operations for rescue at sea and border management. And there has been traction and developments with regards to setting up a system that will basically provide the framework for the relocation, namely migration management support teams that will be deployed at the relocation areas where there will be hotspots set up. So basically there will be a system of screening, identifying people for relocation, and then identifying those potentially that need to be returned. So there seems to be a traction in this set of developments. But of course, there are also the needs that remain and push people to flee the region. In terms of resettlement, member states committed collectively to resettle 22,000 people, which is clearly not enough, considering the numbers that are fleeing the region every day. It is estimated currently that about 400,000 Syrians are in need of resettlement. So 22,000 is obviously not really meeting the needs. But there is indeed a need to reconsider substantially the system of the solidarity mechanisms and the system that exists within Europe in terms of supporting member states, in terms of determining the place where the asylum application is examined and where the person obtains a permit, the need for uniform status across the Union, the need for access to the labour market, and so on and so forth. There are some question marks that we have with regards to relocation in particular, especially, for example, regarding the lack of consent from the side of the individual. It is in theory the asylum seeker does not really have a say in the country where he or she will be relocated. Family links are taken into account, of course, but there are certain question marks about what measures will be used during, what measures will be used after the examination of that case, and if the asylum applicant, for example, does not cooperate in the relocation, will detention be used? There are some question marks there that make civil society organizations worry a bit. But we do want to capitalize on the momentum right now and ask basically European member states to also open up more safe and legal channels for access to Europe. It's not sufficient to try to tackle the situation once people have risked their life and once some of them have died on the way. It is also, and perhaps more important, to open up ways so they can travel safely. And that includes family reunification possibilities that are more flexible. That includes resettlement and other forms of admission. That includes humanitarian visas. That includes private sponsorships and student visas, for example, and this sort of thing. So we do continue to advocate for that, and we believe that there cannot be really a solution by tackling the situation at the islands once people have gone through horrendous journeys, but there needs to be also more before they take the boat.
Okay, that leads us on very, very nicely to the journey that Margaret and Amal have just undertaken to Lesbos, and maybe you can give us a bit of an insight of your experience there, and maybe you know inform us all on what's happening on the ground, whether what we think should be happening on the ground is happening on the ground, and whether you know from this collection around the table today we can maybe remedy some of the challenges.
Want me to start?
You start.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and thank you for inviting me to be here. I came to the UK as a refugee 15 years ago, and going to Greece just opened my eyes to how horrible the situation is. I mean, we didn't have to go through half of what we witnessed. We arrived in Athens on the 17th of September, and we met local organizations and community groups, and they were informing us as to what was going on in Greece at the moment, and obviously in the past as well. We went to visit a refugee camp in Athens, and it accommodates 750 people, and it's opened in August, and apparently it's going to shut in December, which is really ridiculous because that's the middle of winter, so where are people supposed to go? Lots of children and lots of families, mostly from Afghanistan and Syria. People from Afghanistan are expected to stay a few days before they move on with their journey, whereas people from Syria can stay longer. And then we went to Victoria Square, which is a little park in the middle of Athens, and basically there was lots of families sleeping on the floor, and they had no source of support. It was actually left to individuals just bringing water and food, etc. And we saw some people coming in and when they to give you know, support, like water and everything, and all the wee kids would run to them, you know, and it wasn't enough. There was at least a few hundred sleeping in that park, and it was surrounded by local cafes and restaurants. And we were told that actually for the refugees to use the toilet, they had to pay €2 each every time. That was absolutely shocking. And then we left Athens and we went to Lesbos, and we were already like really distressed by what we saw in Athens, but nothing could prepare anybody for what we saw in Lesbos. It was absolutely horrific. We went and met Eric Kempson and his family. They're a British family living in Lesbos. They've been there for 16 years, and they've been supporting refugees for about 8 months now. This has been happening not just since the wee boy's picture was in the media, you know, and it was really sad to see that that's what that had to happen for the world to see what was going on. That boy could have been saved. You know, that wouldn't have happened if the right support was there. So Eric took us around the coastline to see what was happening, and all we could see were life jackets. And all I could think of was, those are lives, people's lives and everything. And he was telling us that the life jackets are supposed to only cost between 40 to 60 euros, but people were being charged 100 euros each, even for the wee kids. And some of the life jackets that we saw were not even inflated. So if people had fallen off the boats, they would drown anyway. And he was telling us for people who would make that journey, they're being charged 1,200 euros each to make you know, that dangerous journey. And the wee dinghy boats were just really, really horrible. There's 50 people who sit on them. And we could see Turkey from where we were standing. And we heard that there's 440,000 people in Turkey waiting to make that dangerous journey. And actually, we were thinking, okay, maybe it might stop during the winter, but, you know, we heard that from the volunteers and the people who are working on the ground that actually, no, this is going to continue. People are going to continue to come. And then the following day, we went again to where the boats are arriving, and we actually saw three boats while we were there with, obviously, families, and we went and helped people get off them. And one mother from Afghanistan just gave me her child, her five-year-old girl, so that she can look for her other kids. And she found her wee baby, and she thought her wee baby had passed away because it wasn't moving. Sorry. And then she started breastfeeding the child, and then thankfully, the child is still alive. Sorry. You want to go?
Yes, it's very, very emotional. It's a shocking state in Greece. To understand, people were mainly moving through Greece on. Obviously, Greece is very poor. People were moving on. And the situation now is much, much worse because the borders are being shut and people cannot move on. And if you look at the violence at some of these borders now, the violence at Calais from the police, the violence in Hungary from the police, and the fact that the Hungarian border is now almost completely surrounded and closed. And how is that a solution to completely unarmed families with babies and children? How can that possibly, in Europe, be a solution to it? We saw people sleeping in the squares, and they had been moving on, but now they won't be. And that camp is going to close. And there are places where we've identified three projects which we're helping and are going to try and help with housing through the winter. But the problem they now have, just in the last fortnight, has absolutely multiplied numerous times compared with what they had before. Tents and sleeping bags are useless. I mean, it's the winter, it's children. The temperature sometimes doesn't fall quite as low as sometimes in Scotland, but it's low enough, and it lashes with rain. So, and people will die from exposure and lack of food. These projects are trying to do something in an organised way, and people do come down, local people come down and help. But some businesses are obnoxious about it, of course. So there's that. The fact that we all know there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of unaccompanied minors in Europe generally and in Greece. And one of the projects we're trying to help, because we've crowdfunded, and I mean, people have been enormously generous, but it's a drop in the ocean. But they have this fund for refugees. They've got premises and a fund for people who are desperate, for instance, maybe needing medical care, and they're trying to help some of the kids. They said they've helped children unaccompanied as young as 10. As if it's not bad enough when you imagine quite a few of the kids that come, as we know from in the Parliament and committees, we've discussed it before, you're usually talking about maybe youngsters 13, 14, 15, as they get here, perhaps usually from Afghanistan. So it's talking about children as young as 10. In the confusion, a lot of children get separated from their families, and there's no facility at some of these borders, particularly right now the Hungarian border, I've read just in the last few days, well-meaning journalists trying to help families reunite with children, trying to get into places where the authorities are not letting families go to try and find their lost kids. So there's all of that, complete absence virtually of the NGOs or the European Union on the islands. I read a journalist's comment on what I was doing. I was at a reception centre giving out food. The reception centre was two rickety tables under a tree, 2 minutes from the sea. We were making sandwiches, Nutella and honey sandwiches, juice for the kids, water. And that was where the boats were coming in, or round the other bay, the boats were coming in. Hundreds and hundreds of people passed my eyes in something like 2 hours, little kids. So that was it. And that family and the people that take solidarity holidays and come from different bits of Europe, the personnel change like every week, they're paying £1,000 a day roughly on water, juice and pan bread that dries very quickly, honey and jam sandwiches, Nutella sandwiches. And yet it's crucial people were asking, do we have to pay? And can we take another sandwich? And, you know, they just couldn't believe that no one was charging them. And it was absolutely shocking, the state of some people. They would go up onto the road. Now, to let you understand, until about a month or 6 weeks ago, when the temperatures, I work in Old Money, the temperatures were over 100 degrees, it was a 65-kilometre walk to where they were supposed to register. Until about 6 weeks ago, there were no buses. People walked that with women, children, babies, elderly people. They walked in that heat with the bottle of water given at this reception centre. When we arrived, it was the first day they'd had doctors. So they had little folding chairs, two doctors and a midwife, which was good. One woman was in a state of actual trauma. She was completely wrapped in blankets in a, you know, really in quite a serious medical state when we arrived. So it was good that there was a doctor there. And that was all just ordinary volunteers. And this is Europe, you know. So that was what we saw there. When it comes back to Athens, I think it's a very, very serious situation. There's almost none of the proper sort of plasticky wooden type container type things that you can have. I believe they're reasonably cheap, but they're the only things that are going to keep people warm and dry, and there's almost none of them. No one knows where they're going to come from. I have to tell you, half the money we took in cash, half of it was used to bury people who died on the boats that went down that morning before we arrived. Because one of the little volunteer camps we went to, one of the 100 million things the women did was attempt to link up relatives who'd turned up with any bodies that had been recovered. And she said, yes, we've got 3 funerals to pay for this week, so that's what we'll use the money for. Because they had bodies and they had relatives. Often they have bodies and no relatives, and they have relatives and no bodies. Looking at the way the sea changed, the weather changed as we were there, from the beautiful diamond sea to the, you know, you'd have thought you were looking at the North Sea in December. You could have refilmed the cruel sea, and that was just the very start of autumn. And these dinghies will not be launched anymore. It will be the more rickety, the fishermen's boats, but some of them are falling to pieces. I think people will come as long as it's remotely possible to come, but it will get more and more and more dangerous. I presume for some months it simply won't be possible to launch boats, but as long as it's possible to launch a boat, it's everyone's opinion that people will come and people will die in that sea. And if they get to Europe, look at what they're facing. People like me, I'm not a professional aid worker, neither was anyone else. I could give out water, I could be nice to people. It was better than nothing, but that's what they've got. And then when they get to Athens, they've just got these wee projects, wee local projects, again, volunteer projects run by all sorts of just humanitarian people, people who've been teachers or are teachers or were social workers or are, and it's in their spare time, and it's money raised locally or by people, as they thought we were heaven sent, because we'd arrived with £2,000 and we said we had a few thousand more that was coming. It's millions of pounds that's needed. What is the European Union doing? It's one of the richest organisations in the world. And there's no excuse now. It's months and months and months these folk have been arriving in Greece on little islands smaller than Lesbos even. Months and months. I don't feel there's any excuse now that something isn't being done. The UNHCR buses are finally there so that people don't walk 65 miles. They don't turn up every day. We had started to panic. Hundreds and hundreds of people had lined up. We were hoping the buses were coming, and they eventually did. We heard the next day the buses just didn't come. So people started to walk that day. The same kind of people started to walk that day. So that was really what we saw. That was what it was like. I think we were fortunate. We didn't actually see any boats going down. And the buses did come that day. Nobody died in front of us that day. So I suppose we were fortunate. But it was one of the most distressing, astonishingly appalling things I've ever seen in my life. I've never expected to see such a thing in Europe. While Europe itself did not have some kind of major war on its own land going on. I think it's inexcusable. If there's anything the Scottish Government can do, there was a small NGO, this really, really small NGO from, I think it's Denmark, was supporting Eric and the family, who just happened to have a house on the beach. They were decent people, house on the beach for 14 years, doing his bit of artwork and selling his wee sculptures, and these boats started arriving. So that's what they, so they started. They've got no normal life, but fortunately, every week a few folk come and help from some or other bit of Europe, and that's really the way it is. That's what's going on right now. It needs that European fund to be put in, money to be put in. I don't understand why Hungary has been allowed to build a fence all the way around its country. How many other countries would be allowed to build a wall all around their country? Are we going to have the whole of Europe with fences all around the... Is there, you know, I wake up in the morning and I think, how many other countries are going to build a fence, and are we going to have a whole of Europe, every country's got a fence around it? Why are they being allowed to do that? Why are riot troops being allowed to wade in to women and children? Why are people being tear gassed in both Calais and at the Hungarian border? Women and children and babies being tear gassed to stop them trying to get through this border. And something has to be done. But with that little NGO, because obviously no one who's helping quite rightly wants to take cash in their hand. If you're raising money by public subscription, as we are, you want a paper trail, and there's a little local shop will take the money from people who are donating it and give a receipt and then give the goods to Eric and his family and the people. And this little NGO has a bank account based in Denmark, and it will funnel funds of any kind. It's properly set up, although it's small. So if the Scottish Government has any money that they have from any fund, that is one way, because that they're not going to stop arriving on that beach all the way through the winter and into the spring. The little camp where the woman was organising the burial of bodies, if necessary, and trying to get more ground and proper, not tents, but proper units, that has a bank account properly set up. It's appalling that you're thinking of talking of that's what you're working through, but that's what you're working through. These people impressed me enormously. They're absolutely genuine. They're not taking any money. They're watching that they're not accused of appropriating any money. There was one person we saw there. He was he can't walk. He's had very bad injuries, but he could walk, but he's not getting the medical care. There's a possibility he could walk. There must be hundreds of people in that state. But when you think of the little kids, to me, the little kids on their own, I was a teacher, so I just can't imagine children younger than the ones I was teaching on their own in a big, you know, continent at the age of maybe 10, 11, 12. We need to, in all common humanity, we need to start doing something. We need to cut through the bureaucracy where that can be done, and we need to take a hard line where countries are not accepting the responsibility. This is not some major disaster, God-sent disaster of buildings have crumbled and a tornado has gone through. This is simply human beings fleeing something that actually a lot of our governments created. They're only just people who could contribute so much. That's all they are. It's not some kind of monster has arrived. All we need to do is speedily process them. There should be no question people are sent to a country they don't want to go to. How would any of us like that? It's ridiculous.
Margaret, see the NGOs that you've talked about, can you make sure that you give us the information on that? Because yes. We certainly, you know, would be making some sort of a recommendation anyway. So having some of that information to pass on, especially maybe I see John's got his ears open there, especially to the task force. There's an issue that raised my attention on some of the issues about children, and I've been raising for a while the issue about the Syrian resettlement scheme not allowing family reunification. Yes. And that's something I think that the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary have been pushing at the Joint Ministerial Committee's meeting and I believe last week as well with the Foreign Minister in Westminster. But one thing that jumped, this place this afternoon will pass, I think, world-leading legislation on human trafficking with very specific measures in that, which I've pushed myself on children. and trafficked children. And I did hear a report a few weeks ago about some of the trafficking rings, you know, moving into places like some of the islands in Greece and maybe Athens and some of the other countries. And I wondered whether that's something that you had picked up any sense of at all.
The people who were accused of trafficking were locals at the point when there were no buses, and local people took their cars to drive people.
So they were being arrested. There,
they were being arrested for people trafficking. It's what Aspasia said. If there was, or somebody else, if there were proper routes, safe routes, there would be no traffickers. That's the truth of the matter. You talk about, you know, attacking traffickers. If the routes were open, there would be no traffickers. Yeah. And yes, I'm cautious about all this, these figures on trafficking, because, I mean, one Sunday I read that 50 cars turned up, so that it was like a blockade of cars taking people, all local people, because local people had been arrested for picking up pregnant women and children and things like that to take them round to the capital, Mytilene, where they could be registered. And they were being charged with people trafficking, which was ridiculous. But that was exactly how the laws were being implemented, not in a progressive way, but in a specifically punishing way of anyone who was helping. The other thing I should mention, of course, Golden Dawn is the third biggest party. On the islands themselves, and particularly on Lesbos, the people who were helping, the local people and the businesses, anyone who was helping, they were running the risk of being threatened by Nazis with knives and guns. It was that dangerous, and some people were getting threatened with their lives. And the police, in many cases, doing nothing because the police were somewhat sympathetic to the Nazis. So it's a very difficult situation. But at the human end of it, yes, I think we were both, and Pinar as well, very, very, very distressed by it all. Yeah. You just feel, we were so pleased. People have been very generous with the little bit of money in our crowdfunder, and there's loads of, we're doing it as an organisation, but loads of individuals are crowdfunding, and people going out for their holiday are taking a suitcase especially of clothes and all of this, and that's what the aid consists of. Ordinary people in this country and other countries on their holidays taking extra, taking a bit of money, spending some days helping with the reception centres, etc. That's what the aid consists of in one of the most, you know, progressive, industrialised continents of the world. And it's brilliant that these people, ordinary people, are doing that. But it's, at the end of the day, I was embarrassed when I came out and said, well, we've got some money. And like, well, it's £1,000, £1,500 for each of the projects. They'll go through that in no time.
Okay, Margaret, thank you. Alison, you want to come in? I think Claire wants to come in after you.
Thank you. I wanted to come in on and reinforce the point that Margaret was making around trafficking, smuggling, and the chaos around what those terms actually mean and then how they're being used. So one of the contexts I've been following is the routes from East Africa up towards the Mediterranean, and how that's differentiated, and how it is people are able to come to Europe safely, how much money that would cost. It's about £15,000 in order to get the right kind of documentation or the right kind of routes that might allow you to come in. If you don't have that money and are in the situations precisely as Gonzalo was describing, then the situation is far more complicated. And some of what then happens, particularly to young people, is what is essentially being indentured into the human movement trade. So what you will see are young people who have fled parts of the conflicts in different parts of East Africa, and particularly a very large number coming from Eritrea, who don't have any means to make the journey, but will then be brought along, tempted into here, somebody who gives them a tiny ounce of hope, or might even give them something as basic as food and water, and then they become part of the work of moving the people, until such time as they are believed to have worked their passage, at which point, and we have seen this happening particularly in Libya, they're given the keys to a boat and asked to sail it across the Mediterranean. When we say, as a country, we will stop this by stopping the traffickers, we need to remember that some of the people we're describing as traffickers are people as young as 16 who've just been given a gun and keys to a boat that they've never sailed before. We will stop this when we take direct action to intervene with absolutely sufficient aid when we intervene to ensure that we are stopping the profiteering from the arms trade that keeps this in place. We will stop this when we spend money on human protection rather than the vast sums that we're spending across Europe at the moment on border security. There are ways of redirecting the resources we have towards making sure that the situation that Margaret and Amal have just described, but which has been going on for decades now, is able to stop if we put that resource in. And in 2007, the young girl who later, as a matter of public record, became my foster daughter, was plucked out of the Mediterranean by an Italian rescue helicopter, taken to safe land on Lampedusa. There were many people on her boat, very young people in that very precarious situation. The poorer you are, the more desperate you are, the more likely it is you will end up in these dreadful situations. There is a question of means underneath this, and we need to be very, very careful when we're looking at what we're describing about saying we're going to stop the traffickers. The stopping the traffickers is not the solution. The solutions lie much further down.
Clear.
Thank you, convener. I mean, we've heard very powerful testimony from a number of the witnesses this morning, and there's so many issues I'm sure other members want to pick up on. It's difficult to. One thing, and Margaret's description was, I mean, it sounds horrific what's happening in Greece. What I noticed was a lack of reference to any of the UK or international aid organisations. Not to suggest that this is their responsibility, it's government's responsibility, but however, you know, Save the Children, Oxfam, no evidence of them. And do other people around the table have knowledge of the kind of work and support that they're doing? The other thing is, I think there's also the issues that have been raised this morning are so broad, you can lead to a sense of powerlessness. What can we as a parliament, as MSPs, do in this situation? So I don't know if people want to comment on things that are within our control around how do we, what will our reception for refugees be like in Scotland, those type of issues. I know people have raised unaccompanied children already, and the convener has an interest in that. You know, how do people feel Scotland is equipped to deal with some of the big challenges that are coming towards
us? I think that sort of leads us on, you know, quite well to the next section. And I think maybe Derek, it's nice to see you again, Derek, and we've been working together on some of these issues for a very, very long time, including a trip to Ireland where we were given some advice on how to integrate people here. So, Derek, it's really good to have you here. But you're here representing COSLA today, yep. And I know COSLA is a co-convener of one of the subgroups in the task force and a very, valuable member, an important member of the task group. I wonder if you could give us, in light of Claire's question, a wee update on where COSLA is, and then I'll maybe come back to some of the individual organisations who are doing stuff, and including, we were really keen to get a rural aspect, so that's why we have Argyll and Bute with us today. But Derek, if you could maybe lead off.
Thanks, convener. I think what I'm going to say now almost pales into insignificance, given the testimony that's happened so far. But I think you're right, we need to bring it back to what we can do, and what, in my position, what local government can do and has done. So the kind of background is that there was a real impetus around that horrible image in particular that made their TV screens, and we were inundated with contacts from local authorities. There's been a whirlwind of things happened since then, and it may not seem that way, but there genuinely has been. We've been asking 32 local authorities specific questions about what their state of readiness, what their response would be, how they would do things, and we've given them 24 hours to respond to us. And anybody that's ever worked with 32 councils will know that's not the easiest thing in the world to get a response to. But to be fair to both the political and officer leadership and all 32 councils, they've responded every time on time, and we have taken in papers to get a political mandate around how we respond to this through both Communities Exec Group and leaders last Friday. And it's been heartwarming, to be honest with you, to see the types of response that we've had, and even those local 32 councils want to play a part. That's not to say that 32 councils will provide accommodation, because in some respects it's probably not going to be appropriate for some of them to do so. However, 32 councils are committed to helping in any way they can, and our understanding from a variety of different local authorities about what's going on in their local communities is that there's a huge number of communities being represented, and local authorities opening up the premises that they own for both food banks, for clothes banks, all that sort of stuff. So we're involved in both. We have a weekly catch-up with Mr. Youssef in the Home Office in terms of progress, and we are involved in all the different both Scottish structures that have been established, and there are UK-wide structures as well. And it seems almost petty to talk about money, but it's important, and I think it's important for two reasons. If we're bringing people from any of these camps, it's important that they're given the opportunity to settle and integrate as much as is going to be possible. And there's also the responsibility to host communities. The level of public services around a whole load of areas that we would expect these people will need is not what it was 10, 15 years ago, and we need to try and ensure. So our position, a very blunt position to the UK government, has been that there should be more money than was currently in offer in terms of the scheme. There should be less bureaucracy, because I think we spend, and Duncan and others might talk about this a bit more, but I think we, both the Home Office and ourselves, spend a huge amount of time filling in forms and jumping through hoops to get money, when the bottom line is that money needs to get out there into communities and help these people settle and integrate. The issues that Syrian refugees coming into any part of Scotland will have will last for more than a year. Some of the mental health issues in particular probably won't become apparent until after the first year, because there's a whole range of things about getting a house and get kids settled at school and that sort of stuff. So we're looking at the potential for a multi-year deal, people coming in with 5 years status, and we think that the funding should be for as much of that period of time as is possible. We still don't know what the financial offer is, frankly, and we've been promised for the last 6 or 7 days to get some clarity on that. My understanding at the moment is things are sitting with Treasury, and David Cameron may have to put his foot down, so here's hoping he puts his foot down soon. We have got, on top of the structures that have been set up, we already had 5 local authorities that were signed up to the Syrian VPR scheme, and what we've done now is extending an invite to the other 28 local authorities to be involved in an officer group through our tutelage that would, in fact, the first meeting's this afternoon, and we've got, I think, 32 councils coming along to that. And that's important, because what we use is the experience that the likes of Glasgow and others have got, and we can have local authorities benchmarking that and finding out that type of information. But equally, we've also had some more rural authorities involved in the Afghan staff scheme, for example, who don't have varied multi-ethnic populations in their area, and come up with a whole range of different obstacles and difficulties in how they do things. Two of the authorities couldn't source halal meat for the first fortnight. Very basic practical things like that need to be considered. Two of them don't have a mosque. So it's where people can go and pray. So it's that type of stuff that's, I think, been invaluable to others in terms of how they take this forward. We are very likely, either by close of play today or first thing tomorrow, to give the Home Office a list of local authorities that are ready to go now. So I suppose it moves things beyond this, people signing up, and I think a lot of people will hear, there are committee structures and there are political processes and that sort of stuff about people want to do stuff, and a lot of stuff would say, what does that actually mean? What that means is that we'll be given a spreadsheet to the Home Office. The Scottish Government will get it today as well. As I say, if not today, tomorrow morning, given what's going on, but certainly in that timescale, within a day, we will be well aware that significantly more than half of Scottish local authorities are ready and willing to take Syrian refugees before Christmas.
Well, you're testament to the fact that sometimes the wheels of government and Civic Scotland or Civic wherever just sometimes can run much quicker than they usually do, and we wish you the best for that. But you know, linking from yours, I think maybe if we can have an update, because Glasgow, you know, have been here many times before in some of the relocation programmes been involved in. The reason why I know Margaret Wood is as a Unison steward, I get involved with the Glasgow campaign to welcome refugees many, many years ago. So it would be interesting to get an insight from Glasgow and then maybe from yourself on, you know, some of the rural aspects which pose both challenges and opportunities. Duncan.
Okay, thanks. Just say we've been involved in a number of schemes. The Home Office approached the Council in February 2014 and asked us would we assist with the Syrian VPR scheme. I think that was in the back of we'd done the asylum dispersal contract from 2000 to 2011. We'd been involved in the Iraqi locally engaged scheme for people who'd worked with the British Army, and we were already discussing with the Home Office about a similar scheme for Afghans. So we had a bit of experience behind that. So they asked us in the February, would we assist? And we said we would have a look at it. And we got into discussions with colleagues in health and education, social work, housing providers, third sector, COSLA as well. And at that stage, it was a wee bit unclear who would be coming to Glasgow. We knew it was families in camps, but we didn't know what condition people would be in, whether they would be coming off a flight and going to the hospital, or were they going to accommodation? It was that unclear at that time. So we asked the Home Office to provide us with the cases that they wanted Glasgow to take, and we needed the full medical details. Once we got the details, we sat down with health and we went through them all, and we decided that we could take the families that they were going to send us. I think at that time it was 63. It ended up it was 55 we took. There was a couple of problems with accommodation that we couldn't accommodate people. So we spoke with the Home Office probably all through the summer, and that's Derek's point about things taking a while to get agreements and funding in place. The first flights came in October 2014. I've been dealing with the Home Office for 15 years, and that was pretty quick, I thought. It usually takes a lot longer. So I was caught in the hop a wee bit, how quick they'd done it. And I think that was for the staff out in the camps who were able to get the visas through right away, and then we get flights arranged. So the first families arrived at the end of October, and we took families November, December, January, March and April, I think it was. So the first families are coming up to their first year in Glasgow. They're all still here. They don't need to stay in Glasgow. They can move on. They've got leave to remain. But we always advise people in any scheme it, wait till the kind of your period's over, all your stuff's up and running. The kids are all settled in school. The kids would have been in school within 4 weeks in Glasgow. They're all speaking fairly good English now. They've all got an accent like me. It's harder for the adults, I think. They obviously miss their homeland, their culture and their families, and some people have made the point that families are split all over the place. They're in different camps, some people are in Germany. So they continually ask the staff about family reunion, and I think that's something we do need to take up with the Home Office. But in general, I think they've settled in well. It's difficult to come to Glasgow, totally different culture, we know that. But we always say to them, just take small steps. You'll go forward, you'll go back, but you'll be getting there. As I say, the adults are beginning to pick up English now. They've all seen doctors. There isn't any trauma yet, and I know that could come in later. People haven't really spoke about their experiences, but we'll wait and see if they do. They're integrating into the communities. They've all got a personal integration plan that we go through with them. The ones that arrived first were about to get them permanent housing, which I think is crucial as well, because it's kind of temporary at the beginning. But we've got a good relationship with the housing associations who gave us flats, and were able to turn the tenancy, if you like, into a permanent let and to become a tenant of whatever housing association it is, and they get to keep all the furniture that we gave them and the white goods. So it gives them a start. And then moving forward after that, when their English gets a bit better, they'll be looking at employment, etc. So there is positives to come out of it. We're already in discussions with the Home Office before the current crisis. We'd been speaking to them about taking some more for the camps, and they just sent us a list this week of 63 cases who are in camps in Lebanon and Iraq, asking can we take them by the end of October, which might be a bit quick, but we might be able to take some people by the end of October, but we need to get into discussions with some of our housing providers. We've got some housing available just now. We need to speak to the Home Office, and as Derek said, we do need to find out about the funding, because we are currently probably, the scheme that's running just now is going to change, I think, because it does take too long. So we've got a current grant agreement. They might want us just to run with that for this group, which would be fine with us, but I think going forward, we really need to speak to the Home Office and say, what is the funding for this? What is the funding for local authorities? And I agree with Derek's point, it needs to be a five-year thing. It can't be this. The way it works now, it's a grant agreement for every kind of batch of families you take, which is no good. You need to say, over the 5 years, we can take X amount and get the funding for that to cover education, but health as well, and the support that people need. And I think I can't stress that enough. It's not just about taking the numbers and putting them in a flat. You need to provide support, and it's pretty intense at the start, especially as you're trying to get them all registered with doctors, into hospitals if they need to be seen, get all the kids into school, get their biometrics, which without that you can't get anything else done, bank accounts, DWP, benefit, all that happens fairly in the first few weeks to get that up and running, so it's important that that happens. But I think at the end of the day, we've seen the first families here, they seem happy enough, they've not forgotten about their past, but they're not having the trauma that Margaret was mentioning, and they're settling in, and we'll continue to do our bit.
Thanks very much, Duncan. Can we get a wee insight for Argyll and Bute? And then I think, Joanna, you'll be able to answer some of the real challenges that people have when they get here as well. And then we'll come back to sort of some open comments.
Okay. Morag. So what we've done in Argyll and Bute is that we've set up a refugee resettlement group. We've been fully endorsed by council to do that. And we've put that within our community planning framework because we know that we can't do this alone. It absolutely has to be done with our partners and our RSLs. We've got very, very limited experience of taking in refugees. We've done it through our homeless service. We've had families from Zimbabwe and before, but we're talking small, very, very, very small numbers. But they're still here and they've integrated well. But that's been over, you know, a period of time. So this is a real considerable upscale for us and what we've done previously. But it was very important for us that we matched the scale of our response to the resources that we have available. So we've made a commitment to take a minimum of 20 families in the first instance, because to us it was really important that we managed to integrate families and we gave them a home, not just a house. We're fortunate, well, if you can call it fortunate, that our declining population and we've got an oversupply of housing that means we have actually got the housing issue isn't as much of an issue for us. However, the size of those houses may be an issue in relation to the number of bedrooms they have in relation to the size of the families that will come in. We'll have to be quite careful how we match that. We've got an awful lot of one-bedroom, or we've got more one-bedroom houses available than three-bedroom houses available. But we will look at that and speak to our colleagues in the RSLs. So we've started sort of roundtable planning within the community planning partnership, with the third sector, directly with the communities that we would be looking at housing people, with social work, education, health, with the police and with the local college. But as you kind of touched on, there's going to be real challenges for a very rural authority. Religious, we don't have any mosques. Halal meat will be a challenge for us. The biometric passports, that will be a challenge. I mean, our distances are so extreme. We've got our islands. You know, it's going to be a challenge, but it's a challenge we're absolutely up for, doing everything we can. And we feel that, you know, we need to look at the resettlement, but also the integration, and we need to almost be running two plans kind of simultaneously. So, you know, that's where we are, but an absolute commitment. And there's been a huge amount within Argyll and Bute. The communities themselves have been collecting and donating and taking stuff, and I know that stuff's been on its way, you know, over to Greece and everywhere else. It's been a really huge effort.
It's really heartening, absolutely, to hear that. And I think there's some key people around this table today that I think you should network with, who can certainly, you know, Glasgow has got a lot of experience in this. Some of that you know that our activists have got great experience in this grant net. But maybe I'll bring Joanna in now, who can give us an insight into Joanna's Five Migrants Network. Who,
Five Migrants Forum.
Forum, sorry. There's so many forums and networks, but they are all doing extremely valuable work. But you'll be able to give us an insight into some of that, you know, the integration aspect of it, you know, some of the challenges, but then some of the resolutions for that. And I would hope that at the end of the committee, you'll link up with Morag and give her some support as well.
Yes, so over the past several weeks, we've been working hand in hand with Fife Council on a Fife Welcomes Refugees initiative, which we now linked with an UK-wide Welcome Refugees initiative. So what I would like to highlight is the importance of the role of the third sector organisations and the community groups in the local areas. They will play crucial role in integrating refugees into communities. We are developing a volunteering and befriending project we are hoping we'll get a lot of local people involved. We speak to interfaith groups and we are planning a lot of events around cultural awareness and training for caseworkers and third sector staff. I think what is important to also to mention that we need to think about two strands of work. We will be working directly with refugees who at the beginning will receive support from the local authorities, but that will fulfil only their basic needs. And the third sector will be there to fill the gaps, which are very important because when we asked people who were the refugees, some of them are our volunteers, the first thing they said when they arrived was, what was the most important for you? They said to feel welcomed. Other organisations we contacted mentioned that the first and foremost is to keep them busy, keep them active, keep them in touch with the communities. So there will be a lot of activities that we will have to develop before we can progress them to employability. With the employability, I attended a meeting with Scottish Syrian Association in Glasgow, and one of the issues that was raised that people don't have a confirmation of their qualifications, for example, and there is nowhere to confirm their diploma. So if somebody is a doctor and would like to work in the country, then how do we go about that? Are we doing enough to raise awareness on why people are fleeing their countries? Are we do enough to inform our communities? And whose responsibility is that? Is it third sector? Is it local authorities? So that's one of the questions. And then resettlement of the refugees needs to be carefully thought through. In our view, people need to be housed in the areas where they connect with other people, or housed close to other families, refugee families, or close to links to support. They can't be left on their own somewhere and spread. And the last thing I would like to also mention is the debate in media. And I feel there is a huge need for a truly independent press regulator, because the lies in press cost lives. And independent press standards organisation, there is an evidence that it's not playing its role in controlling the media. So that was the last point I wanted to raise. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. And I think we've managed to hear from all of our, I guess, we are really, really up against the wall for time here. And I'm prepared to go on for another few minutes for questions. I know, John, you want to back in. And I want to maybe get some insight from Aspasia, given what she's heard this morning as well, and maybe from Gonzalo. But, John.
I'll try and be very brief. I think Claire asked the most poignant question earlier. I mean, with all the things we hear and the experiences that Margaret and Amal have experienced, you know, what can you possibly do faced with such a huge situation? And it's very easy to get caught in that and think we can't do anything. But we can do things. And I think what the Parliament and the government here can do, for a start, is to keep the pressure on the UK government. I mean, 20,000 people over 5 years is two or three boatloads that came over in a day. Germany's committing to taking hundreds of thousands of people. Now, I know there's a public opinion issue there, but I think properly managed and with political leadership, the sort of political leadership that's been shown in Scotland, actually, I would say, if that could be shown equally at a UK level, rather than the sort of grudging approach that's been shown, I would say, then those are two things that certainly parliamentarians can do, because public opinion may very well change and shift, and it's important when times get tough again, if that happens, that people stand up and keep making the arguments that this is a humanitarian issue and not a migrant issue. Language is so important here. Other issues that we could do that could significantly help would be to, as been said a number of times, to ask the UK government to review its family reunion rules. There are several thousand Syrians already in the UK who have been here under student visas or have been here for a number of years. If you could regularise their position and then allow them to bring their families. Currently, the family reunion process is viewed as an immigration process and not a humanitarian process. So it very much limits the people that can be brought in. I think for this situation, the UK government is within its absolute policy power to change the rules on family and make it much more easy. We could sort out a lot of people to bring into people who are already living here, already established, and that would help thousands of people. I think we also need to be clear in the language that the local authorities have clearly outlaid what the process needs to be and what the challenges are. But we also need to see these people not as a burden, not only as a burden. They will come in, and lots of them will have particular needs and need support, but a lot of them will come in also with huge amounts of personal resources, skills, and a lot of them will, the first thing they'll want to do is get into the job market and support themselves, and we need to sort of capitalise on that image as well. We also need to avoid the situation of seeing Syrian refugees as somehow good things, but remembering that there are other people in the UK asylum process continuing to come through as refugees, and that they all need to be considered, and one doesn't need to be done at the behest of the other. And how do we make all this happen? I mean, Scotland's saying we're going to take 2,000 to 3,000 over 5 years. We're a population of 5 million. I think if we could look at the way the process operates and coordinate it better, and if we can demonstrate that we can actually take the numbers that are coming in first effectively and well and settle them into community so there isn't dislocation and people, you know, are prepared, then we could take a lot more. So I think what we would say is that the current Home Office process is probably not the best route to scale up to the thousands. And Glasgow articulates, Duncan articulates so well the sorts of challenges that have to take place, but that's because there's a whole infrastructure that supports that in Glasgow that isn't replicated elsewhere. So I think we need to think of new ways, and COSLA is going to be, and local authorities are going to be really critical to this, about how we can adapt and change the process to coordinate, and some of the services that Duncan talked about are specialist services that don't operate everywhere, that they only operate. The biometric identity cards, which have to be issued to a person before they can do anything else, which is issued by the Home Office. Only two post offices in Glasgow do that. So how can we marshal some of those specialist services that the DWP have about giving people national insurance numbers, some of the key tools that people have? And that's what we're going to be focusing on in the integration subgroup, working into trying to other new ideas we can have. And if the Home Office could be persuaded to delegate the bit that Scotland does with the lump of resource that comes with it, I think actually Scotland come up with much more creative solutions that are tailored to the environment and the agencies and organisations. May not happen, but those are things I think that Parliament and government here could do in terms of keeping.
Yeah, I think you're pushing it an open door on that one, John.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you know that. Alison, and then Willie Coffey's going to come in.
Underneath the remit of the resettlement, I think there's a number of things this committee could usefully keep in mind as we're looking at how that develops over the next 5 years. My concern is the differentiation. We have a group, the Syrian vulnerable people, who are coming in on a particular route. My concern is what that does for the other people in the asylum and refugee process and system. I think we need to really look at that, as well as, exactly as Derek said, really working with different host communities. Those differentiations are very acute. They're about whether you can work or not. They're about where you live. They're about a whole range of different aspects which could breed resentments. And if we really are serious about New Scots integration, then we really need to look at that. That's the first point. The second one is, I think we need to look at the 5 years. It's 5 years refugee status. We've learned a lot since the five-year refugee status was brought in. And one of the things we know is that in year four, if people have maybe had 3.5, 4 years studying as one of the things they do as young people, it's very difficult to get a job if it looks like your status is running out within the next 12 months. We're talking about people, the refugees on refugee status or people on humanitarian protection status, who will hit that point in 4 years' time and therefore revert very quickly. And all the research shows this happens. If you can't get a job, as Joanna was saying, if you can't stay active, then the vulnerability comes right back up. And all that wonderful work we've done around integrating and with the health services and looking at mental health in particular will be reversed if we do not have a plan for what we do in 4 years' time when we're looking at the end of that. And that needs to be a plan for those coming in on the Syrian scheme, on this present scheme, but also for all those who have refugee status. What do we do at that point to stop people becoming vulnerable again? Languages. You can't learn another language in 60 hours of ESOL support. Nobody can. We know what it takes to learn a language so you can do your job well, because it's the kind of training we give to diplomats when we place them overseas. We know what it takes. It takes quite a bit. And I think one of the things we could do usefully is revisit some of our language policy within Scotland, look at what we mean by languages. We're actually still quite hidebound, I would say, by a set of language policies for schools, but also other areas, which is based on, forgive me, where middle-class people want to go on holiday. And I think that at the moment, in terms of the grand problems that are actually facing us in society and worldwide, the languages coming to us, that are being brought to us by people at the moment who are being resettled, are very much the languages of the future. They're the languages of the future in terms of humanitarian aid, but also in terms of international relations and in terms of trade. I think we really need to be thinking about that as part of this, because every single piece of research says that once people have adequate housing and adequate food, what actually is needed is the language to be able to relate to other human beings with. And finally, this committee, to follow on from what Joanna was saying, can really keep an eye on the discourse we use in public. I think Scotland is to be commended, and the Minister is to be commended for the discourse that has been used so far. The research done on genocide says, on point four on a 10-point scale, that when one group denies the humanity of another group and members of it are equated with animals, vermin, insects, or diseases, dehumanization overcomes the normal human revulsion against murder. What we have seen in our press, but what we have also seen from the Prime Minister, is the use of language which does precisely that, which equates other human beings to insects. We really need to keep an eye on that. It's extremely dangerous. This is not just something to do with political correctness. It's about how we understand other human beings. And I think really focusing on those aspects to make sure our public discourse in Scotland is very careful and attentive to the research that has been done on how dangerous that kind of language is vital. Thank you.
Thanks, Alison. Billy Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think at the outset I have to say thank you to colleagues, some of the colleagues, for the very moving contributions that they've made, particularly Amal and Margaret there earlier on, but also to commend the work going on in Glasgow, and thank you, as usual, to Glasgow and, of course, to Scotland for the efforts that are being made here. Colleagues, we're witnessing the end of a nation here, I think, aren't we, in Syria? I was just looking at some of the statistics there. There are 22 million people living in Syria. 4 million are now abroad. 7 million are displaced. Another million we don't know about, and three-quarters of a million are dead, probably more. This is a humanitarian catastrophe, and the European Union has spectacularly failed here. I wanted to come back and ask Margaret, and hopefully our UN and European colleagues, what more should be done immediately It seems to me that the rescue efforts in the Mediterranean are nothing short of a disgrace when you've got a small navy like Ireland rescuing 7,000 people in the last few months and other navies are not there. They're missing. There's no coordination going on here. So should that be a priority to get into the Mediterranean to rescue these people? Or should we be sending our navies from the European Union to take this equipment and this accommodation equipment that you mentioned, Margaret? Should we be taking it there and installing it in places like Lesbos? Because it's a real tragedy for the people of Greece and Italy who are themselves suffering at the front of this, to have to bear the brunt of this rescue operation that's going on. So if you can give us a message today as to what we should do and the message we should give to not only to our government and the European Union, what should it be? What are the priorities? Is it rescue? Is it accommodation equipment? Is it food? Is it medicine? Is it basically get your act together to rescue this people and save this nation?
Margaret, I think the first thing would be to actually open the routes, because if you opened safe routes, then people wouldn't need to take the perilous journeys. But until those are opened, and I suppose there have to be agreements, but that is the first thing, then yes, of course, we should be put in proper... the end of Mare Nostrum was just disgraceful, and the fact that that boat that's there now from Britain is basically a Frontex boat or ship. You have to proper search and rescue and proper immediate humanitarian relief in Greece, in Athens, in the cities where people are going to be living rough over the winter, but also just speed up, actually, you know, allowing these people to have status somewhere. It's really the sort of the most drastic disaster end of help is the bit that shouldn't really need to be done, because if you speeded up all the processes and allowed people to come safely, you would never need all that. But right at this minute, yes, you are going to need all that, because it's just all these wee organisations and people like myself over there trying to house people and feed people. So it's the two things you need. But, you know, opening the safe routes, speeding up the bureaucracy and giving people status in countries appropriate and where they want to go. It's not it's a tiny proportion of the European... It sounds like a huge number of people, but it's a tiny proportion of the European population, and they bring so many talents and resources to us. But where that doesn't happen, yes, an immediate major disaster operation needs to be put into process so that people don't die in the streets, in the cities. It's not just Greece, of course, it is Italy and France and Spain, but and then that people also don't die on those seas. The Mediterranean is becoming a grave, truthfully. The day that we went, it was 40 people died, including one entire family and a newborn child. We have to stop that. I don't know if that helps. I mean, those are the safe routes immediately.
I think maybe we'll bring in Aspasia at this point. We are really seriously running out of time now, and I want to bring you back in. I know that you've sat very patiently listening to all of the testimony we've had today, but maybe there's some specific European questions there that I wonder if maybe you could give us some. I don't suspect you'll have all the answers, Aspasia, but maybe some insight into, you know, some of the action that's been taken to address some of the concerns.
I couldn't agree more with Margaret and what she says, and I think we've all stated it, that the answer is really to provide legal channels, to provide people the possibility to travel. It is just so unfair to see why we all can take the plane to go somewhere and these people just can't. And there are many ways to do that, and member states have done that. One of them is humanitarian visas. France has issued 1,500 humanitarian visas to Syrians over the last couple of years. So basically people go to the embassy in Beirut or wherever they are, and they can get a visa, which is for humanitarian purpose. This is not asylum. This is just an entry ticket. And they can arrive to their member state and then enter the asylum procedure. This is already saving their life from having to take the boat. Then there are, of course, the family reunification possibilities. Right now, it may take 2 years for somebody to get reunited with their family in Europe, and it costs thousands of euros, which they may not have. Why shouldn't it be made more, well, should be made easier and faster to reunite with your family who are already living in the UK, in France, in Belgium, and they have refugee status? Is this just so obvious, but it is made so difficult? There could be possibly also a lifting of visas from certain countries in order to allow people to travel. And of course, this could be only a temporary measure for a short while, but it would substantially reduce the risks that people take and the risks to their lives. Then there is, of course, the humanitarian forms of admission. Germany, Austria, Switzerland have used this, which is basically the possibility for family members, extended family, not nuclear family, so brothers, sisters, cousins, already living in the member state, to help bring their family member over. And all what the country needs to do is provide the permit, the residence permit and access to the asylum procedure. They are granted sometimes a temporary protection status. In other cases, like Austria, they have been actually granted refugee status. But basically, the families say that they actually take charge, and they don't need state entities, authorities do not really need to do anything. This is expedited. This is fast. This can help get people safely to their destination without having to travel. All these possibilities are there, and they should be used. It's just that we all witness a lack of political will. And there are certain member states, of course, that have been more generous than others. And it's very, very saddening to see also certain member states, especially Eastern European states, with their history now becoming the most conservative and closing down the borders. I would also just add one more thing, because I see on my camera, on my screen here, that apparently the session will expire in 10 minutes and I will disappear from your screen. So maybe just on the resettlement practices, some of the things that we have seen by collecting practice from different member states. One of the things mentioned was, for example, the skills and the qualifications that people might have had, the studies they've done before arriving, and how all this is lost. Doctors and engineers who arrive and then there is no diploma, of course, in their baggage. And how do they prove that? And how could they actually, how could that be capitalized so they also feel valued? It is quite stressful to be a doctor and then have to do cleaning jobs. I mean, all of us would feel the same. So there must be ways to support this. And actually, there is a practice in the Netherlands. There is an organization, an NGO called University Assistance Fund, UAF. And what they do is basically they support people to enter the Dutch university system with loans and grants. So they do a shortcut and maybe complete one more year or 2 years in the university, accompanied with a language course as well. And then that basically brings them back to where they were in terms of their professional profile, or maybe they want to adapt it slightly to the particular circumstances where they are. But it is a way to restart your life in dignity and decency, and also to feel valued and that this is also fulfilling and it's not a failure. And that's very important for integration. Other things that we have seen a lot, for example, from other countries that have been doing resettlement, is the need to combine language training with vocational training and access to the labor market. It is a waste of time to spend a year just learning the language and then try to enter the labor market, whereas this, in some cases, they try to combine this in one training. So actually learning the language is also useful in the sense of preparing for access to the labor market. And of course, the bottom line here is prepare, 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 both for both sides. It's not only about the housing. It is not only about the NGOs to prepare. It is also about preparing the people before they arrive. For example, information about their housing needs should be already transmitted before they arrive. So one knows what's the number of members in that family, what house would they need. Cultural orientation is not only for the refugees in order to prepare for the situation they will have when they arrive, or the cultural context and so on. Cultural orientation is also necessary for the structures and the stakeholders in the host society. They need to see a video, they need to get to learn a bit about what does it mean for these people, where do they come from, what do they do in their spare time, what do they like to do, what is their music like, many things about, you know, how to connect the two sides. And there are a lot of countries that have been involving the communities, the existing ethnic communities in that. For example, a video that shows Syrians already living in the country, that shows how they experience that, what it feels like, and this video is screened already to the people before they arrive. It helps them prepare to understand what it will look like when they're, if they hear a compatriot talk about it, it's easier than hear somebody from an organization talk about how it feels like and what it is like living in that particular area and what community work is like and so on. Many things have been said about the role of volunteers, the role of mainstream services, and not just the specialists. It's important to involve the schools, the local, not only the local authorities as well, but churches, the GPs, different types of stakeholders that are not the usual suspects. But they will also come across, and they will also encounter, they will liaise and interact with the new arrivals, and they will need to be prepared. And finally, I think, for example, for the Syrians, it is important to consider there needs to be immediate access to psychosocial support. There are serious traumas here. People have, even if they're resettled and so they haven't taken the boat, they haven't gone through that experience, still, I think going from their home country to Lebanon or Turkey is already very traumatic. And I think there needs to be, that should be taken into consideration when in relation to housing and access to this kind of services nearby. I'm afraid that my connection will be cut quite soon. So I'm wondering whether I should just wait, or maybe already thank you very much for inviting me to join the debate.
No, thank you very much, Aspasia. Our connection will be cut too, because we have to be back in the chamber very soon after 11:30, so we can't sit beyond that. But can I thank you in behalf of the committee for your information? If you want to share anything more with the information, please, you know, get in touch with the committee and share that. That would be very helpful. Gonzalo, I want to give you maybe the final closing remarks this morning, but we have very, very limited time to do that, but maybe an overview. But very, very quickly, I have got a list of STAD items: family reunification in that process, funding, NGOs, where are they, integration services, open and safe routes, humanitarian visas, and possibly a temporary lifting of visas. Mm-hmm. If there's anything missed from that that you think should be on it, can you let us know? Gonzalo.
No, I mean, I would say just to wrap up that I think the key is that European states will be able to manage this crisis once they agree that, in fact, all the different mechanisms to address this problem are as important and should be supported by all states. Because what you've been seeing is states picking and choosing, you know, like a menu, saying, oh, we don't like relocation, we prefer resettlement, or oh, all the aid should go to the refugees in the region. And yes, search and rescue is okay, and others say, no, in fact, it's not okay because it's an incentive. In fact, they have to realize that all of these aspects are absolutely necessary and should be supported, and you cannot pick and choose. Yes, aid to the region is absolutely critical. Yes, we have to use much more the legal ways for refugees to get from the region to Europe safely. Yes, that includes resettlement, but that includes the many other mechanisms mentioned by Aspasia and other colleagues. And that, yes, relocation is also critical and should be supported. And of course, whether the UK can opt in or out, I think there is an issue of It's not a legal issue, it's an issue of solidarity. So until all the aspects are supported by as many European states as possible, this issue will not be addressed.
Thank you, Gonzalo, and I think that brings us to a nice close, although this issue and this topic will not be forgotten about that easily by this committee. There's probably a few recommendations that we need to make in relation to some of the evidence and the pleas that we've heard this morning. We did invite the Home Office, the Home Secretary, to a committee this morning. Diary clashes didn't allow that, apparently, but it would have been nice to get the answers to some of the questions from that aspect. And I think from this committee's point of view, we will look at some of that as well. Can I thank you all very much, not just for coming to the committee this morning, but for all the work that you all do. None of the position I think we would be in right now in Scotland would be there without some of the absolutely crucial work that's been done over many years. And Aspasia said, prepare, prepare, prepare. I think Margaret Wood has been preparing and preparing and preparing, not just services and networks and organisations, and there's many people in here who are all part of that, but preparing all of us for you know, how we should react when fellow human beings are in extremity. And I think, you know, it's nice to see that we can get all around the table and agree a way forward, but, you know, not just say we're talking about it, but we're actually doing something about it. And I thank you all for what you do about it. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm going to close committee now. Thank you.